Hello, my name is Mark Kushner, and I'm an associate professor of hospitality management at Community College of Philadelphia in the Culinary Arts and Hospitality Management program. Today's seminar will be Flambé 101. In these programs, as you've experienced as well in restaurants, we have both what's called front of the house and back of the house. I represent the front of the house areas where I come in direct contact with the guest. The back of the house area, the culinary arts, of which we have some amazing programs here at Community College, is the area responsible for the production of the food. This is a unique service today because it's a crossover. Back of the house production is being done in the front of the house. And almost always when food preparation is happening in the dining room, it becomes a derivative of a French style of service. In our later video, known as Etiquette 101, you'll be hearing about French style of service, English butler style service, banquet, as well as buffet. For today's purposes, we'll be concentrating on a French style of service. And in order for it to be a French style of service, it's not just the use of the rolling carts. It really means that while the ingredients could be consumed, there is one step further that must take place before service. That service could be the combination of ingredients in the form of a Caesar salad. It could be the deboning of a poultry or fish item. It could be a carving in the form of a Chateaubriand for two, or in many cases, a flambé, which we'll be doing today. We are warning you, we are professionals. Do not try this at home. Doing so may result in the loss of your eyebrows or even further damage to yourself. Most importantly, if you are in the industry or trade and will be doing any type of tableside cookery, please check with your insurance carrier, as not only the liquids that we use, but the techniques could affect your coverage. The equipment that you see, because it is from a French style of service, we're going to give you a little bit of terminology and a little bit of education as to the processes as to which we're going to make use of. The first one is the cart itself. The cart is called a guerdon. The burner is known as a richard. And in both these cases, these are the tools of the trade. And these tools belong to, you guessed it, front of the house, not the back of the house. And because we are going to be talking about flambéing, and we are going to be talking about the use of fire for cooking, nothing really new to civilized man, we have to give you two quick seminars. And in the area of pyrotechnics, you have to remember that energy will go to the point of least resistance. A closed container in a pyrotechnic environment will result in an explosion, while an open container, whether it be open on any side, will result in that energy being released through that opening. Hence the difference between obviously a grenade and or that of a rocket. So the rocket has that source. To show you, historically, the explosive quality of that closed vessel, during the World War II, when Russia was being invaded, there was a point where weapons were at a minimum, and a general decided to fill bottles with gasoline. And that cocktail was actually named after him. You may have heard of him, General Molotov. So we want you to keep that in mind when making use of any pyrotechnics in any way or form. You also have to be aware that since we are going to be flambéing, is what causes that combustion and what are really the elements of fire. And when we deal with fire, obviously there has to be a fuel source, and we'll be discussing that in a few minutes. It could be anything from wood to alcohol to sterno, but anything that's combustible can serve as a fuel source. The other two things that people don't realize about fire is the need for oxygen and temperature. You may have heard of something called spontaneous combustion. And spontaneous combustion occurs when there's so much temperature, so much heat, that a fire occurs while the ignition source is almost unknown. And we also know that to maintain that fire, an oxygen supply is required. So the best fire extinguisher you can buy is a CO2 extinguisher, because not only does it eliminate the oxygen supply, it also lowers the temperature. And most importantly, you have to remember that when dealing with combustible materials, ignition can occur from even static electricity or two metals coming in contact with each other. That now brings us to the point of the burners and the richards themselves. Restaurants traditionally have found a number of different heat sources for cooking the food and preparing the food at tableside. If you're going to really be preparing the food from scratch, a gas burner is generally used. And a gas burner is a very low flame, a very hot flame. Unfortunately, there is a noise to it, and it's not very decorative by nature. Sometimes going to the other extreme, we deal with a very decorative source of fire, maybe in the form of a sterno, very little heat, very decorative in the form of its flame, but unfortunately not very useful. What we're going to use today is something somewhat in between, which is something known as denatured alcohol. And by using denatured alcohol in this burner, what we have the ability to do is to create a large flame, a semi-larger amount of heat compared to sterno, but not that hissing, actually cooking from scratch as in gas. And again, in a commercial restaurant environment, the maintenance of a large gas cylinder on your premise may in fact adjust your insurance ratings as well. As we deal with the cart and the rechards and everything here, we have to teach you another form of French. And that French term is mise en place or mise en place. Now, this is a term that we use in the restaurant industry in a number of different forms. A mise en place means I walk into the restaurant and it, just as it says, everything is in its place. Mise en place means that when I bring the gridons and the accompanying carts into the room, everything is here. I don't want to do a Caesar salad and suddenly find I'm missing the anchovies, which need to be pressed into the bowl to make the true Caesar dressing. In that case, the mise en place would not be in place. We also refer to the mise en place not only for the room itself and for the carts, but occasionally we will be presenting implements to the guests and we will present it to them on a mise. And a mise is a plate and a napkin, and we also refer to that a mise en place. So it's actually used in a number of different forms. The pans that we'll be using today are a very unique pan. And the reason we say that is it is of a tri-metal environment. And it's trimetal because obviously you know copper is the best conductor of energy as well as heat, hence copper wire versus other derivatives. Unfortunately, if the pan was entirely copper, that same level of heat, that could result in burns. So what we use instead is brass. Brass conducts heat at a much slower rate than copper. So those are the two metals in play, both copper and brass. And most importantly, to make sure that there's no change in flavor or color or chemical reactions, what we've actually done is lined the pan with stainless steel. So this tri-metal pan, produced by the Spring Brothers in Switzerland, is perfect for flambéing and also has a very low rise side to it, which makes the ability to catch a flame that much easier. The first thing that we're going to do when we get ready to do this is to light the burner. And again, please do not look over the burner while doing that. And while you may not be able to see it in its entirety, this burner has an adjustable air vent. And as we mentioned before, as you add more air to it, you will get a higher flame. And that's the effect that we're looking for. So what we'll basically be doing is keeping the flame on low as to prepare the sauce or the items that are done. Many people think of all the different nuances of flambéing. And one of the areas that we think about constantly is crepes. And crepes are small pancakes that are flambéed at tableside. And while many people think of it as legend, it is actually fact that in the late 1880s, 1895, a young apprentice waiter, an assistant waiter at the age of 14 by the name of Henry Carpentier, was in charge of the chafing dishes with these elaborate pancakes and desserts known as crepes. Unfortunately, the Prince of Wales and the princess was with him. And at this event, the cordials accidentally ignited. And we'll be talking about the dangers of that and how to avoid that in a few minutes. And when that ignited, he was so concerned that the sauces would be ruined and there was not enough time as the dessert course was being served to redo it, he sampled the sauce and found not only did it not ruin the sauce, it had combined the ingredients in such a way that it made it better. And not only did the Prince of Wales, who would later become King Edward VII of England, enjoy it so much, he put down his fork and used his spoon to consume it. And he asked Henry Carpentier, "What do you call this dessert?" And being the sharp front of the house individual he was, he says, "We call that crepes princess. He says, "You know, I have a lady with me today." And she stood up and she curtsied and she says, "My name is Princess Suzette." And after that, he asked, "Would you mind naming that crepe dessert after my accompaniment here in the form of crepe Suzette?" And he said, "It would be my pleasure." The next morning, from the Prince of Wales, he received a gift of a Panama hat, a cane, and a jeweled ring. And this was proof, even in the 1800s, the importance of tipping. Now, as we get into the pan itself and we're starting to heat up the food, we're going to start placing the liquids into the pan. As you hear that little sizzle, this is a restaurant expression we use constantly, known as sell the sizzle. Because this really is an exercise in showmanship. This is an exercise in salesmanship. This is not for the eating public. This is obviously for the dining public. And we do want you to understand that this is also a sales technique. And this is something for a special occasion. But we do need the entire pan to be covered. If you picture the size of a single silver dime, if a single silver dime size space is open in this pan and the liqueurs come in contact with that pan, what will happen? Well, obviously, that combustion will take place. We're also concerned that not only does the pan be covered in every single corner, that as we're placing the liqueurs, we keep in mind not only the possible inadvertent ignition, but the different liqueurs that we're going to be using. As you look at the different liqueurs, you have to realize that unlike beer and wine, we do not measure liquor and liqueurs in percentage. Typical beers run about 4%. Wines are typically anywhere from 10 to 18, with the average being 12 to 14. And after that, we get into the category of spirits. And when we deal with spirits, the alcohol content is so high, we try to blur it a bit by using something called proof. And each of these items has a proof on it. Proof is 0.5%. For those of you that are math challenged and haven't taken any math courses here at Community College of Philadelphia, you do understand that 0.5% results in dividing by 2. So we have a liqueur product here, which is 50 proof. Mathematically speaking, that would make it 25% alcohol. In addition to that, we'll be using a brandy item. The brandy is 80 proof, making it 40% alcohol. And most importantly, a beverage to be consumed with great enjoyment, coming from the wonderful island of Puerto Rico, from a company we give great thanks to, Bacardi. We have Bacardi 151, 75.5% alcohol. Now, when I talk about the proofs, you have to remember, as they gain in proof, they gain in alcohol. As they lower in proof, they tend to have a higher specific gravity because of the higher fruit content. Ergo, the lower proof items are heavier, and the higher proof items are lighter. So we want to place the liqueurs over the sauce in such a fashion that the heaviest one goes first. Now, because I've done this many times, and I don't want to take any chances with that combustion, we'll be first pouring over the top of a spoon to disperse the liqueur evenly and it doesn't slide under the sauce, which you can see is already bubbling. We're going to pour the liqueur from an open vessel. And again, what's the worst that can happen? It would flash. Where a closed container, you might not think there was any danger, and many of you may have seen it in restaurants where they're using a speed pour and they're pouring directly from the bottle, the stream can catch fire. And the immediate reaction is to go like that. And the stream will follow itself into the bottle before it even hits the liquid, will hit the vapor and explode. And that server will then be referred to as lefty. So to avoid that from occurring, we pour over the top of a spoon from an open vessel, knowing that the worst that can happen is a slight flash. We also want to make sure that we have a napkin in our mise en place, because flaming fingers are not in style at any time. The next item that we're adding is of a brandy nature. And the brandy nature is, again, the same time added over the top. So we're basically floating the liquids. But most importantly, I mentioned to you earlier about something known as ignition. And when we do the Bacardi 151, an easy technique, is to think of this as a clock and in one quadrant to pour a little extra liqueur. Because if we are thinking ignition, and we are thinking pyrotechnics, it only makes sense that we leave room for a fuse. If this bubbles too much or comes to a boil, what will actually happen is the liqueurs will slide under the sauce, and that's not what we're looking to do. We now switch this into the higher position, which gives us more flame, and as we slide to the side, we allow it to ignite. And as you can see from the heat, we now have a flambé. Every time the pan starts to diminish in flame by strictly striking the side of it, once it comes into contact with the open metal, you'll see the flame flare up again. We reduce the heat to reduce the boil. And historically, as happened with Henri Carpentier and Crepe Suzette, we have a special dessert. Now, everything we've talked to you about so far is a blend of the modern way we do restaurants in salesmanship and showmanship, as well as the historic side. So today, we're going to do a historic fruit flambé. And being in the city of brotherly love, we are going to present that a la crimpette, or a tasty cake to those of you in the know. And it's very typical in the restaurant, because we've already learned about the process of tipping, that this be presented to a special guest. It could be the young lady for her sweet 16. It could be the person that just got engaged. It could be someone celebrating their 80th anniversary. Well, they may not remember it later. And again, as we mentioned, the dessert is presented to a special guest. And as our viewers, we would like to present you with this special dessert. My name is Mark Kushner, and I am an associate professor of hospitality management at Community College of Philadelphia. And again, thank you for joining us today. And if you have any further questions, please contact us at Community College of Philadelphia. But that's all, folks. Cool.